Namaste.
Namaste.
So I did a wedding Friday. And you know, I'm semi-retired from weddings. But I prefer to characterize it as, starting next year, I'll just be an extremely exclusive provider. Meaning you're going to have to work pretty hard to talk me into one. But there was a woman who did one of the readings. There was one biblical reading and one not. And the biblical, I was trying to think what the biblical reading was. It was 1 Corinthians. Because that's not predictable. They had picked this woman for some reason to read this, and she had what I call game show microphone problem. You know how this used to happen all the time on, what happens on Jeopardy? There was another one. Where they'll have the microphone and relative to the contestant, it's down here. The Price is Right, too. And the person goes to say something and they feel compelled to go, yes, Bob, you know? So she gets up to read this reading, and the microphone is a handheld even, but I don't know how she was holding it, but all I saw was the top of her head as she read, a reading from the first, okay, so loud, screaming into the microphone, carrying her leather-bound copy of the New American Bible, so I knew she was a lector, finishes and has to say the word of the Lord, even though that's not in the text for the wedding, goes and sits down with her Bible on her lap. She walked out of my homily right when I got done with the genie joke, which is pretty early, you know. And I thought, yeah, that's what Pentecost is about. Because see, there was, for those of us on the UAC clergy email list, somebody sent a happy Pentecost greeting this morning and I responded in tongues.
Is that what that was?
Yes. the hell of that's tongues. These people, and Jim aced the reading, which doesn't happen very often, all these obscure places. The truth is, these people were not all these places are not in Israel. And what's that?
Most of them.
Yeah, most of them are not. And even the Cretans understood.
I was just going to say that I didn't know the UAC was invented at that time.
Well, that's, you know, because they were the ones sitting in the corner going, ding, 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 right? So what it was a transcending of boundaries. And not just the boundary of language, but a transcending of the Jewish idea. And remember, earliest church is a Jewish church. That there, as I used to tell my kids, and they used to remember, I don't know if we should quiz Tori. We used to say there's two kinds of people when I was doing a message in church. There's Jewish people, and they would be trained to answer everybody else. And everybody else were called Gentiles. So there begins at Pentecost this transcendence of that boundary between Jews and Gentiles. Or at least they want us to believe it started. How effective and how thoroughly that penetrated could be debated. But, and I also want to say when it says the fierce wind filled the entire house, the entire house probably comprised the space that we're sitting in here. But nevertheless, fierce wind filled the entire house. I don't want you to think it was like, you know, one of these homes out in Mequon, you know, where the wind had to be strong enough to blow through 6 bedrooms, 4 bathrooms, you know. But I just finished is it reading if you listen to an audiobook? It's rehearing, re-listening? Re-what?
Relearning?
Yeah, well anyway, Elaine Pagel's book Beyond Belief, which I read.
Whose book?
Elaine Pagel's. It's called Beyond Belief. It's ostensibly about the Gospel of Thomas, but it's actually also about the earliest church. And so I had done it in a book study back in 2004, and it probably wouldn't be bad to do in a book study here. And then I picked up the audio version because I didn't want to go through all that work and I could listen while I was walking the dog. And I was reminded that this whole thing kind of flipped. So earliest Jewish Christian church, Jewish only, Jewish predominantly. You have Pentecost, and now everybody understands everybody else. It's a breaking down of barriers, a breaking down of walls. And then you flip it now till when Gentiles start taking over the church. And they start looking for reasons to cast themselves as the chosen people of God, and cast the Jewish people as having forfeited that in any number of ways, but most often by not accepting Jesus. But even within this increasingly Gentile Christian church, they were cutting each other off, metaphorically. It's a circumcision thing, by the way. But it was, you know, do you believe the right thing? Do you believe things with too much diversity? What do you really believe about the nature of Jesus? Is Jesus really the Son of God? What do you do when you worship? And so in 300 to 400 years, diversity once again gets hacked off. So we go from an exclusively Jewish organization to an organization that in the day of Pentecost is opened up to everybody. To a couple hundred years later, we've been narrowed right back down. And now, we're that girl, God love her. Thinking to ourselves, well, ain't that special? But, I think people are starting, have started, to see the problem with that. And so this reading from Maharaji, which interestingly enough, the sub-ek thing isn't just saying when he wiggled his fingers. The extended reading talked about how people were asking him, you know, is it all about Krishna? Is it all about Shiva? Is it all about Christ? What is it? And he was saying not only is everything one, but all those religious expressions are really one. There isn't this division. There isn't that separation that something innate in human psychology wants to create, which is my God is better than your God. And it's especially, to me, repugnant in monotheists who say there only is one God, therefore you have the wrong one. Well, now, wait a minute. that's a contradiction. If there only is one God, then you can't have the wrong God. And, of course, the implication is, well, yours isn't really. You only think your God is God. And which brings me to Bernie Glassman and Star Trek. Star Trek nerds like me will remember the Tholian Web episode in the original series, where the Enterprise, Kirk gets on a ship, a different ship, another Starfleet ship, and they encounter these Tholians. First time they encountered Tholians. So the Tholians start to trap the Enterprise by weaving a net. And the ship's flying back and forth weaving this net, and what it's weaving is Indra's net. There's a lot of Eastern spirituality incorporated in the original series that's not there. And this idea that everything in every joining point in Indra's net has that pearl in it that reflects every other's point in it. It reminds me of when I worked at Marshall Fields, right after I graduated from high school in the men's department. And I used to, when I was bored, like going back to the suits, the men's suits department. And they had those three-way mirrors where the two sides are adjustable, you know? And I learned that if you set it up just right and stood just right in there, you were reflected forever into the mirror. You know, it just went back and back and back and back. That's Indra's net. You know, it's that point at which everything reflects everything else. And Bernie Glassman, who's a rather controversial, actually just had a stroke, but he's a rather controversial Zen teacher because he tends, and I can't believe, let me just say, that anybody would do this, but he tends to transcend and stretch the rules for ordination. Yeah, and for passing on the lineage. But he also does
retreats at Auschwitz every year.
Where you actually
go sit in Auschwitz. You know what I'm trying to say. It's kind of like Shelley Shelf, She Shelf. That's Sean Connery. Shelley Shelf, She Shelf, She Shelf. And before he had a stroke, he did street retreats as well, which is where essentially you live as a homeless person on the streets of New York City for a week. And you're required to not bathe or shave for a week before the retreat, or brush your teeth. Because what he's trying to do is get people to experience the true homeless experience, which is hard to experience when you're, you know, freshly bathed and using deodorant and all that good stuff. And so I actually have a lot of respect for him, I think, sometimes. You know. The thing about eccentric people is, you know, sometimes everybody looks at one and goes, oh, man, I wish he, you know, that one thing has got to go. But he too is saying, in that Indra's net idea, from the Zen side, it's all one. Everything is contained in everything else. Everything is reflected in everything else. So I don't have to feel that the fact that somebody is selling flowers at the airport with a really bad haircut, it doesn't have to bother me. In fact, it shouldn't bother me because it's all a reflection of the same thing. I don't have to worry that Tom Cruise jumps up and down on Oprah's sofa. Well, maybe that is cause for concern. But I don't have to worry that he wants to eat his baby placenta. No, maybe that. Well, he's okay that he's a Scientologist. You know, unless somebody is getting hurt, I think the message of Pentecost is really that, you know, it's okay. You can let it be. And if somebody tries, on the other side of this, if somebody tries to box us in, say, oh, good Christians don't do that. You know, that depends kind of on when you're talking about in history. And so, unless I'm hurting somebody, that's not a problem. There's no such thing as the one true God if what you're trying to say by one true God is I'm the only one that has it, or me and people like me are the only ones that have access. And how ironic that Pentecostals and other charismatics took the whole thing of Pentecost and the speaking in tongues and turned it into an exclusive club and said, well, if you can't speak in tongues, you really don't know. You haven't had that second baptism, you know, the one in the Holy Spirit that you get after you get dehydrated in the top of a hot building with no air conditioning and keep you awake for a couple days.
You know, after going up to the altar to try to speak in tongues for like 6 weeks, I finally just went, you know what, I just like, sure enough, the preacher was walking around telling everybody what I was saying. Okay, well, that just proved how unauthentic this whole thing is.
I'm trying to picture you doing that, and it's like,
I know what you mean.
Yeah, and it's, we have a need to feel special. And it's okay to need to feel special. I think we're all inherently special. The problem comes in when the only way I can figure out to make myself feel special is to make some other people less than special. And if we can change our mindset into one of the Indra's net, or Sub-Ek, or the Pentecost experience, that says, we're all connected. So if I do something to put you down, I'm putting myself down. You know how a spider discovers that it's caught something? Through the vibrations in the web. It's not that it marches around on patrol and looks to see, checks the trap. Something flies into the web and it vibrates and the spider knows. That's, and remember, Indra's net is made of, it's a big spider web. And so whatever happens to one part of it, happens to all of it. Shakes through. Does that make any sense?
Mm-hmm.
It's just, you know, I picture that and I just kind of see like, it's kind of like the pearls of every structure. Just kind of imagining that, yeah, anything happens, and it's like a ripple effect. It just goes through everything. It's, you know, you think about our world, and it's like, you know, even the smallest thing can have such a huge effect on so many other things. And it's kind of the idea is like, you know, even something as minute as like people, you know, for example, killing a bug, right? But so many people kill this bug and then it's gone and it jacks up some greater ecological thing.
And we were talking this morning when we walked the dog that it's interesting to me anyway, how worms, you know, sort of aerate the ground, but so that they don't completely make it chaotic, there's birds who come and pluck the worm off the ground and keep things to a manageable level. And yet somehow we think, and in the earliest church there was this debate, you know, that we're still having, I guess. What about creation? Are we responsible for the creation? Can we just do whatever we want with it? Do we need to destroy it in order to get to wherever it is we're supposed to be next? And if you look at the balance that exists in nature, it just, you pretty much have to check your brain at the door to believe that what we do to the world around us won't impact us. You know, let's dump the oil into the rivers. Let's fire up the coal plants again, because it won't matter. Or worse yet, it'll hasten the return of Jesus.
Oh, what?
Oh yeah, it's millennialism. If we could just destroy the world, Jesus would come back.
He'd be pissed.
They don't tell you that part. Yeah. Jesus is coming, look busy.
Like, I come back for this.
Yeah.
When I think about connecting Holy Spirit, with, especially with the Hebrews web, is Christian language of God as Trinity, Spirit inherently part of the one that is three, that then enters and indwells everything that is, and hovered over the water and created everything that is, so that God stuff that is spirit, that is always part of the three, is always part of all that is, without being, you know, like chunked up a little bit. And it is, it's mind-boggling, but I think that when we can get back to that understanding, as opposed to now you get your shot of spirit because Bishop, you know, confirmed you, and then you get a little bit more because he ordained you, and then, you know, it's like God is not particleized.
Well, that's a good word.
And yet we're all part of that God stuff that always was and always will be.
Yeah, it's we, in my usual, much cruder way, I would say that we imagine that God is even more chicken shit than we are. You know, that the nitpicking and it just never ends. And so I don't like the guy down the street, because I don't know what they cook in that house, but it doesn't smell like food to me. And now, that's different from saying, good God, what are they cooking down there? You couldn't pay me enough. You know, but I haven't decided not to like the guy. I haven't decided that, you know, something needs to be done about that. It's just, okay, so he's having
nettle soup.
Yeah, nettle soup, curried sphincter, June bugs, whatever it is.
Ew.
That's fine. He can eat that. I don't have to go over and eat it, you know. And that's, there's a huge difference between that and saying, oh no, we got to put an end to that. And we imagine that God is just that nitpicky, you know.
Oh, all the while you were talking, I'm smiling to myself, thinking how easy it was to fall into that. You know, that guy that claimed that Catholics were not Christians on this website? And I was bound and determined, you know, to get my 2 cents in about how we were Christians. And finally somebody else commented, you know, it sounds like you're just trying to separate, you know, all the Christian sects. And I thought to myself, why would I care whether the World Council of Churches declared the Catholic Church that they weren't Christian? And I, of course, I had to go there and look at websites.
Yeah,
and they don't say anything.
No.
You know, they don't say anything about the Catholic. In fact, the Catholic Church is not a member because they've chosen not to join, I guess.
Right.
But there are members who are on commissions within that. And, you know, where did this guy get this from? But a thought in his head. But, you know, it was easy. It's so easy to fall into. Wait a minute. I got to defend myself. We're special.
Well, and that's what you know, he's saying, you know, here's the exclusive club, here's the country club.
Yeah.
You know, and instead, I think the best answer to that is the Caddyshack is a very spiritually enlightening movie. Because it's all about the country club. And yet everybody at the country club is a hot mess. And so, this idea that we've become exclusive doesn't really protect us from ending up looking really silly. It is the best movie in the world. Mm-hmm. Well, you get a bowl of soup with that, eh? So. So then what does that mean? So then the challenge becomes, how do we deal with people like the church lady? I mean, from my perspective, she can be as sanctimonious as she wants. She can dismiss me as much as she wants. But what I need from her is for her to be respectful if she's participating in the service that I'm leading. And what I need for her is to sit there. Yeah. And you can look down your nose at me if you must. But it's okay, I believe, to make that distinction and say, you know, we may believe different things, but I'm not going to let you treat me like garbage. That's different from saying you need to see things the way I do. And, you know, we should excommunicate you and all that good stuff.
I think that's what's wrong with them. We're all, like,
can't hear you, please.
So many people are so caught up in the, you know, oh, I can't listen to something else because it might challenge what I think. And I think there's so many people out there who are afraid of having their beliefs challenged, you know, because somehow going to damage their faith if they question anything, and they feel like they shouldn't question anything. So that exposure to other ways of looking at something, it's like, oh no, I'm not even listening to this because
it's a slippery slope. You know, who would have thought that the domino theory from the Cold War in Latin America, which said that if one country went communist, they all would turn into a theological theory among evangelicals, you know, that if you're exposed to the wrong idea, if you get too close to somebody who's, I think we need to give ourselves enough credit for discernment, and not that we can't be wrong, but that we came with a mind, mostly, that unless something traumatic has happened, we probably still carry it with us, and that any God worthy of the name would expect us to use it.
You know, it's like my thought of that too is that what does it say about your faith if you can't have your faith challenged? You know, what does it say about your relationship with your higher power if, you know, something as simple as listening to another viewpoint could totally screw up that?
Well, and maybe it's a separation from, or from, or between, or a movement from the whole idea of loving one another and respecting one another and treating one another well to the idea that faith is believing the right things and that what we do to one another doesn't really matter as long as we believe the right things. Which, I mean, there's no New Testament, or very little New Testament, and certainly no gospel evidence for that. And it's a tool that developed in the earliest church where they started to say, okay, who can we kick out and why?
Well, and I think it's important to remember that the earliest church, well, more like give it 500 years, so we're looking at that Islam developed. But once you had in the same region Islam, Christianity, and Judaism, they had to start, you know, saying this is what it means to be a Jew. This is what you have to believe. Not just this is what you have to do, this is what you also believe, this is what you have to, you know, and this is, you know, what's wrong with these and the others and Christians doing that and the same, because that's when, you know, Christians just got even better at saying not only do we say they're alt, but we got to slice and dice within ourselves as well.
Yeah, although I think a whole lot of that went on before that, that was motivated by power, income. At some point, once you have the religion of the empire, and I think that because you have this these North African Christians and these Mediterranean Christians, you know, and of course things, there's no rapid communication, so of course people are going to think different things here, and they do up here, and then all of a sudden we get together for a meeting, and it's like, holy cow, do you believe those people believe that stuff? and as you get to early popish or pope-like figures, even if they weren't popes yet, and early theologians starting to say, we have to consolidate power. And if I'm going to be the hottest theologian on the block, I have to figure out why Origen isn't. And that's, I mean, I hate to say it this way, but that has nothing to do with spirituality and everything to do with ego. And then once you get religion in bed with secular power, also in Islam and Judaism, well, not so much Judaism. They couldn't get that from me. Now it's like, well, this empire is going to come attack this empire, and they certainly can't do that. And if those people are attacking us, they must be godless. So we'll launch some crusades. I mean, and it was just off the chain. Because in the East, they didn't do that. I mean, there were wars, don't get me wrong. But it wasn't so much a matter of doctrine. That's okay. Maybe we should pray for the salvation of our soul.
Oh, that's pretty interesting. How about the rest of me?
That's right.
Salvation of my soul.